Where? Oh.
I was hoping if I grew my hair out, you wouldn't recognize me. I expect so. No, this is not the State of the Onion. This is going to be more like the State of the Larry speech, and a little bit of the State of the Butterfly. I could have titled this talk, What I Did This Summer Vacation, except it's more about what I didn't this summer vacation, which is travel. And what the reason for that is, let's see. Yeah, that's the reason. The state of California has altitude in most places. And what happened was, many of you know I've had a history of problems with my right eye. I've had a cornea transplant and cataract surgery. Well, I've had that on both sides. And I've had I've lost count of the number of laser surgeries. And the back of my eye was getting jealous about all the stuff happening at the front of my eye. So it decided to misbehave on itself, and I had a multiple retinal detachment, two different surgeries, and the upshot of it was my eye doctor said, you may not go over 2,000 feet. Well, some doctors say 1,500 feet, so, 500 meters. Now, you will notice that most of California, except for the boring parts, are above that. I had to skip OSCON. I could not go to my mom's 90th birthday party because she was up in Seattle. And if you trace all the roads from here to there, go away. There's actually one road that goes up to 1,980 feet. And, we said, we could go that way. And we said that to the eye doctor, and he just made a face. But the real clincher was my mom called and said, you are not coming. I would feel terrible if you came and ruined your eye. So you are staying home. And as an upshot, I got to learn Skype for the first time. Never done that before. And alas, I could not make it to YAPSE EU or YAPSE Asia, all of which we had been planning to go to. But don't feel too sorry for us. California here is quite a beautiful place. It's pretty. There's lots of nice things in California. And it's not like we didn't do any traveling in the last year. A year ago we were in the Ukraine and we saw how well that worked out. When we were there, things were already going a little strange. I blame these people. They've been fuzzed out to anonymize them, or maybe it was this guy. I'm not sure. Anyway, so pardon me for using manual means of inserting things. My program, which takes an impress and inserts text and pictures into it, it works great on the text, and for some reason it's broken on the pictures, so I have to do those by hand. But that's okay. So we went to China, too. That was a lot of fun. That's actually Alaska you see under there. So we flew over Alaska to get to China. How many of you have ever ridden in a 787, the plastic airplane? Yeah. the wings really do bend up that far. You know, like about 10 meters, it seems like, because they're built to do this. That's not the only thing, strange thing about that airplane. I mean, the windows, they don't have things that go up and down. They darken electronically. So the inside of it, sorry, this is out of focus, but it looks like the inside of a submarine ride at Disneyland. Really creepy. You know, we saw lots of interesting things. Lots of temples and buildings and things. They seem to have this thing about dragons, though. I don't know. There's a dragon there, a dragon on the bell. I have a thing about power poles. Wherever I go, I love to take pictures of the power poles because they always look a little different. Germany and Austria have very dark, very solid-looking ones. These are a little more... Not as light and delicate as the ones we have back home, but the most interesting thing about Beijing, if you ever have a chance to go though, is the food. Now you have to enjoy hot food, though you can get by without. But we just had the most amazing food the whole time we were there, and of course we met a lot of amazing people. Yeah, for instance, these look like dice, don't they? They are not dice. What are they called? Dragon fruit. They just have little seeds in them, and they cut them this size, and it looks like dice. This is my favoritest non-bicycle rider. We were there. They have a lot of bicycles. And we went to all the usual, you know, suspects here. But some of the buildings were a little more unusual there. They actually have really good architecture there, for some definition of good. But a lot of strange buildings as well, especially this one. This is like a building up on stilts with a picture on the end. It looks like some sort of a... Yeah, it's actually a TV screen up there. It changes the picture as you're going. Here's another building that's near that. But the most unusual building is the TV building. You can see the little satellite dishes there down below. Fun things you can do with this building is by positioning that lamppost there correctly, you can make it look about 10 meters tall. Or you can turn it on its side. But it's pretty big. We went up the Great Wall. On the way, I saw some of these more power poles. And you know how you can kind of tell the voltage of a power pole, of a high tension line? You know, if it just has one wire, it's fairly low voltage, because otherwise, if it's higher voltage, you get a lot of leakage. So sometimes you see two wires or three wires. This is six wires. I have a better picture later. But I also wanted to show the sign there. Part of my motivation for getting into characters in Unicode in the first place was Oriental languages, and I, you know, so here's a sign here, and it doesn't, you know, really have a cheat key on it. I mean, now I can tell you it says new come goods. Oh, hand branch. I don't remember what that means. City. Anyway, so, and I wanted, if I have time, I'll show you how I look those up now. And here's the Great Wall. Actually, three Great Walls. It's a great place, a lot of fun. Back to power poles. If you look carefully on this, you can actually see, I don't know if I can... Can I actually? No, it won't zoom further. But you can actually see a little sort of hexagonal star holding the six wires. So this thing must have colossally high voltage, or they're really paranoid about leakage. Not everything is buildings. There's some beautiful lakes there, it was kind of windy there, and I liked the way it swept the willow branches there. But mostly, it's some really great people there, except for the guy on the left there, and the guy down front center. But we met some really, really neat folks there, and people all around the world have a lot in common, especially if they're Perl programmers, then they have the same problem. And lastly, the thing I noticed is that the plugs in China look like monkey faces. I should have made that focus a little better. And we also got to YAPSE North America. And before that, we went to... we actually took the time finally to tour Florida. We'd been in the state before, but hadn't actually looked at it, or something like that. We drove down to Key West, and this is a view from Key West. I just wanted to see all the long bridges. I like the long bridges. Key West, yeah, that's okay. And of course, we took our niece to Disney World. Actually, this is at Epcot, but they have all these princesses running around. She's scary. My niece, not the princess. And saw beautiful Japanese gardens. But most of all, YAPSE, we got to trade. I got to do this to Charlie Strauss, and Charlie Strauss got to do this to me. And the joke was that they were going to do, have a keynote speaker there every year who was a famous science fiction author who had also submitted to CPAN, but unfortunately the list was only one long. But that was fun. So that, yeah, don't feel too sorry for us. We manage to get around anyway, somewhat. But then this whole eye thing came down, and we were stuck there, and they told me what they did was hopefully this isn't too gruesome. What they do is they tack the retina back down and they put a big bubble in one's eye. And at least the second surgery was, first surgery they gave me a 2-week bubble, but they had to replace that because of the second surgery. So then they gave me an 8-week bubble. I guess that's 4 times better. But that's like eight plus or minus 2 weeks. So we planned for when the bubble was going to go away. My older son, he's into theoretical physics, and he had been doing a postdoc at UCSB and was doing another postdoc at AIS. And if that's alphabet soup for you, that's misspelled. That's what it is. It's IAS, Institute for Advanced Studies. But basically, they were going to move from Santa Barbara to Princeton. He had to do that over a weekend. They just grabbed their cat and got on an airplane and went. And we said, we'll drive your car across country for you. Road trip, yay. They don't much like to drive, and Gloria and I love to drive and such. Well, I like to drive, and she likes to be driven or something. So the really nice thing about, of course, is no kids. They're all grown up. Well, actually, we love our kids. Our oldest, wow, I can almost read what those say, don't I? Our oldest daughter, Heidi, has just, she's getting published with a comic in a collection of comics, and this has not been published yet, so you may not steal it and publish it yourself. And my younger daughter, who made this picture that is one of my very favoriteest pictures in the world, and I use it for my background. This is a self-portrait of her, how she thinks of herself. But she's the evil one in the family. But she's also settled down, and in addition to doing art, is raising 1.5 grandkids now. And Heidi also has one, so that's 2.5 grandkids we're working on. It's this one. Okay. Here's a paper. Let me shrink that just a hair. This is a paper, the sort of thing that Aaron is doing now. This is actually a controversial paper. He could not get it published at the first journal he sent it to, because he made the response from the editor of the journal was, "I can't find anything wrong with it, but it must be wrong somehow." Yeah, he doesn't like the conclusion, because the conclusion is basically, here, the generalized second law also rules out traversable wormholes, negative masses, and other forms of faster than light travel between asymptotic regions, as well as closed time-like curves. Furthermore, it is impossible to form baby universes which eventually become independent of the mother universe, or to restart inflation. This paper was like, tromping on some large percentage of the physics population's research. So it was not, but he finally got it published. And Lewis, you'll see a picture of Lewis later. What we discovered when we scheduled this trip, though, is that bimixtures are not linear. When they put the bubble in your eye, it's partly air and partly some weird gas. The first one they put in was sulfur hexafluoride. That was the 2-week bubble. And the 8-week bubble is perfluoropropane. And that's the bubble. They also use perfluorooctane. One of them is a gas, the other is a really heavy liquid. They only use the heavy liquid during the surgery to kind of glue everything down, and then that's before they zap it. So I have a little teeny bubble of the heavy stuff left in my eye, which is funny because I have a automatic spirit level. I can see, right? That's up. Because it's heavy, it's in the bottom of my eye, and everything is upside down. The bubble is just the opposite. It looks like it's in the bottom of your eye, and slowly comes up as it goes away. The other one, the perfluoropropane. So we were planning to go and move these guys, Let's see. Is it that one? Yeah, and this is our train ticket. We took the train down, and we very carefully looked at the train route, and it only went up to 1,300 feet. And the bubble was already like mostly gone. And we said, we'll just go there, and by the time, next couple days, the bubble will be entirely gone, and we can take off. And that didn't work out so well, because bimixtures aren't linear. And the air all went away, and then the heavier perfluoropropane just stuck around for another couple of weeks. So we were, looking very hard at the elevations. Now you can easily find the highest in elevation, highest and lowest elevations in every state. You discover things like the lowest elevation in New Mexico is 2,500 feet, but that doesn't really help you. What we finally found was this altitude.nu, which is a really cool site if it was, were in lower resolution, I mean higher resolution here. But you can actually click anywhere on this, and if you're actually on the internet, it will tell you the altitude of any. So you zoom in on the highway as you're thinking of going on, and you click along the highway, and it tells you all of so for instance, we could, that's 10,069 meters there. Here at Tucson, well, it's missing. And, you know, it's only 597. You know, we could probably, if we do it gradually, can we get across? But then it goes up to like, after Tucson, it goes shooting way up to, yes, if I can get it to 1331 meters. Oh, I can do it in feet too if you're an American. My touch screen is way off here. Okay. Anyway, so we used, that was one of our favorite programs at the time, but we found that the lowest way across the U.S. is about 5,000 feet, which is really high, and it's right after Tucson, which is less than half that. So we thought about it a lot, and then my son did the same thing my mom did. He said, if you come right now and ruin your eye for me, you know, we can do without the car for another 2 weeks. So we put that off. And eventually we got to the point where we're going to go across the U.S. in 10 days. And, you know, the nice thing about this is it let me do a bucket list thing. You know what your bucket list is things you want to do before you die. And one of the traditional ones in the U.S. is to visit all 50 states. Well, I had been in all but these states. So, you know, it's the old, let's make different mistakes this time. You know, our daughter-in-law, she's great, but she has to plan everything in advance. You know, her family, you know, they would know exactly where they're staying every night. They would have reservations every night. We're not like that. We're not like that designing Pearl 6 either. You know, advance planning, what? Let's just figure it out when we get there. So, yeah, lazy design. It's a U.S., kind of, in a snowstorm or something. So we were starting out over here. Well, actually, we got the car from down here, and we, after the train ride, we just went back up home and waited 2 weeks. And then finally, the bubble went away. And so now we're going to basically go across here through Utah, down this way, going to miss Texas by about 20 feet, actually, literally. We could have driven into the cornfield that was there in Texas. Down here, down through Arkansas, through Louisiana, up through Mississippi on the Natchez Trace Trail, which was a historical thing that the people, they'd ride rafts down the river and then they'd sell the rafts for the wood and march back home. Up, catch the corner of Alabama here, up through Tennessee, or through West Virginia, up through Pennsylvania and over to Princeton. So, you all know where Fallon, New Mexico is, don't you? Nevada, yes. No, you don't. That's where we stayed the first night. The second night, we stayed at another famous place. About the third night, we realized, you know, we should feature this. Just stay as many places as we can nobody's ever heard of. So we stopped at Woodward, Oklahoma, Bella Vista, Arkansas, I'm sure you've never heard of, Rayville, L.A., well, that's where Ray lives, right? Louisiana. Bowling Green, Kentucky. Wait, isn't Bowling Green in, like, New York or Ohio? What, you know, Ohio? Lexington, Virginia? No, Lexington's, like, in Massachusetts or Kentucky, actually. There's one there, too. when they settled America, everyone kept reusing the same names. That's why there's about 50 Springfields. We never stopped in a Springfield because those are too famous. Reading, Pennsylvania. Well, Reading is actually in, you know, Britain. Of course, half of the U.S. thinks that's pronounced Reading because they played Monopoly. And finally, Princeton, New Jersey, which you've probably heard of. And then Mountain View, California, which you've also heard of if you work there. Hi, Jeff. And then Maria Alm, A.T., what state is that? So we've been really bouncing around here. But, you know, you probably are tired of just seeing names. So this is what Santa Barbara looks like. And that's Aaron and Nicole, our daughter-in-law. They're great for each other. Both really smart. This is, the name escapes me. Lake Tahoe, yes. So we are actually in Nevada looking at California. And if you see that haze there, it's because we just drove past the Placerville fire, which had closed the road we went on a couple days before, but it just reopened, and so it's very smoggy there due to the fire, but pretty for that reason, and because there's a nice model here in the picture. But most of the way across the country was all on these itty-bitty two-lane roads. That's, I think, the only picture I took in Nevada that was not Lake Tahoe. Actually, that was Fish Lake. That was already in Utah. And we were celebrating because Fish Lake is like at 9,000 feet, 3,000 meters or so. So my bubble was all gone, and I could go anywhere, yay! Up at that altitude, the aspens were beginning to turn already. The cows were beginning to turn already. The moss and lichens were beginning to turn already. And yeah, we're kind of beginning to turn too, I think. But this is our selfie at 9,000 feet altitude. That next night at Torrey in Utah, this was the view out of our hotel room. If we looked kind of northwest, if we looked straight out north that way, just kind of panning left to right here, this is. You know, there's all these famous rock formations in Utah, and this isn't one of them. There's Zion and there's Bryce. This is called Capitol Reef, and it's like 70 miles of this, except it keeps changing. You go all through down through these strata of millions of years, or I guess we were going up, weren't we? Yeah, up, back, forward in time, because of the way it was tilted. But it was just, you know, one jaw dropper after another. There's some primitive computer programs on the rocks there. Nice sheep right here. A dog looking at it. That's probably a bear or something. But it was just amazing. Some of it looked like Neapolitan ice cream. And then it got, you know, really dark and ugly badlands. Starting to look more like Roadrunner country here. Okay. So if you ever get a chance to do a road trip, this is a pretty good way across Utah. Here's the lake, Lake Powell, which we had to go. There's three ways you could go below the dam. There's a ferry in the middle, and there's this bridge at the top. We took the bridge at the top. That's the bridge looking back. And this little mound, what was it called? Tea cake? Hmm? Tea? cheese box. I don't know. Doesn't look like a cheese box to me. Natural arches of various sorts. But the most wonderful thing, finally, was after driving through all these strata, there was an explanation of what the strata were that we'd just driven through here. The arch is at this strata, but we were driving through a lot of the formations that you see up above here, and we could finally find out which dinosaurs died in them. New Mexico, they think they have great scenery there, but, you know, compared to the Alps, that's kind of pathetic. Though they do have some really weird royally things there. What was that called? Comb Ridge. It's like this huge dinosaur or huge long snake. Well, there's the dinosaur bones up here, but it's like this huge long snake died there and just stuck. The road actually goes up through here through a cut. Then we went to Taos, New Mexico, and this is a sort of slightly sad story. We pulled into a rest area before this to look at the bridge, and we saw that they were shutting down the bridge. And we were stuck here for a couple hours while this crane here and these emergency responders were fishing out somebody from the gorge who had jumped. And the sad thing is this was like the second in 2 days. So it has become a popular spot. We've always had the Golden Gate Bridge in California, which is a very popular spot. But these things kind of go in fads, you know, unfortunately. The Seattle Space Needle went 20 years before the first person jumped off, and then the next person was within a week. So the church in Taos, it's sort of one of these wonderful adobe structures, which is very historical, you know, goes back many centuries. But it's actually a new church every year because, you know, the adobe dissolves in it's just mud. It dissolves in the rain. They have to rebuild it every year, basically. So, you know, what is it? How do you define the pattern? It's like a waterfall. It's different water every time, but it's the pattern, as it were. And then off through the panhandle of Oklahoma, everyone should drive through the panhandle of Oklahoma once and never again. But what we discovered after we got out of the panhandle that was that we had discovered the United States of America. Unfortunately, my camera, it focused in on the dirt on my window rather than this, so I had to enhance it. But you can kind of see it says United States of America across there. Glad to know where that is now. Oh, they regularly distribute pieces of Oklahoma to the rest of the country with tornadoes, and sometimes pieces to other lands like Oz. Here's the out of focus one. Arkansas, the Ozarks, another natural bridge. This one with a path across it we could walk. Mississippi, there was some cool stuff there. These are actually, the picture is not of hay bales here. It's actually of these mounds here. You can kind of see them there. Actually, these were in the Ozarks too, I think. Do you think it was on the route there? Okay, well, it's a little out of order then, because I think this was in Mississippi. But there's four Indian mounds here. This is Arkansas. Yeah, this is out of order too, because we actually saw this in Mississippi too. It's a beautiful cypress swamp. It's a swamp. These trees love the water. And this is... my shot of Arkansas, such as it is, my 50th, Alabama, I'm sorry. Where would I be without her? So, Yeah, who knows? Yes. Yeah. But part of the Natchez Trace crossed Alabama, so we went up on a hill, and that's the best picture I could get because the trees were all in the way. But I assure you, that is my 50th state, and I saw it on my 60th birthday. Now, that means I lost 10 years somewhere. I don't know. Swamp. This is the Capitol building in West Virginia. You have to understand, I was like driving along, like shooting out my window at this, because there wasn't really a place to stop. They have some nice valleys there, but you know, what they call mountains on the east coast of the U.S., you guys know they're not real mountainy. Now, what my wife is looking at there is actually this, is the eagle flying overhead, and I timed it just right. Some pretty stairs leading to the view of this bridge, which happily, they schedule one day a year for people to jump off of it on purpose. Base jumping and boingy boingy stuff. Yeah, Pennsylvania, we went through the East Coast, you know, mostly history. This is actually the Battle of Princeton in New Jersey, a plaque. It's on a hill. Supposedly. This hill was like about 10 feet higher than the rest of the field. Things are so relative. And finally, we ended up at Aaron's house in New Jersey. Oh, wait, no, this is Einstein's house. Aaron and Nicole are actually in a little furnished apartment that they have there, which I didn't manage to take a picture of, so I put this in instead. But, you know, Institute for Advanced Studies is famous for Einstein having ended up there. So we like to do a lot of, which one is this? Okay. And finally, we came here too, I guess. I will mention that. This was our view from my bed in Maria Alm. You guys have mountains. I freely admit you have mountains. But, you know, there's this question of belief. Sometimes you don't always believe it. Here's the next morning. Yeah, well, this is someone who believes in Pearl 6 and someone who doesn't believe in Pearl 6. Yeah. Actually, most of the time we see the general outlines of Pearl 6 and are still filling in the details here. But we went up, did some driving around while we were here, and got up really high again. We love this. Okay, pretty church. Okay. But I wanted to actually, the reason I showed you all these pictures is because, as you all know, everything that I do ends up somehow attaching to Pearl. So I thought I'd talk about some of the travel metaphors that occurred to us as we were going around. You know, we talk a lot about composability, but travel is composable. You know, you can go from this state to this state and this state to this state, and you put those things together end to end, and you end up with a longer journey. And you hope your computer language works that way. You hope when you call this function, it gives you something that you can feed to that function, or when you hook up pipelines or however you're sending your data around your program, you hope that it will be composable and that you can take a collection of smaller units and combine them into a larger unit that is also composable. And Jonathan loves to talk about this with respect to the concurrency that we're building into Pearl 6, but it's a very good design principle. We knew our eventual destination, but we didn't know our intermediate destinations. We were just playing by ear. And that's a lot of the the way we've done the design, you know, at the beginning we realized we're all too stupid to design this new language. You know, people think, well, just write the spec. And then once the spec is written, you write tests for that, and then you implement it. And then, you know, that's the waterfall chart that we talk about. But nobody that I know of, especially me, is smart enough to do that. So we had to play it by ear and say, you know, we know the things that are obvious. We'll do those and then see where we can go from there. You know, we'll stay here overnight. You know, some places we stayed a year. You know, when we started our trip down on the train, we didn't know our limitations. Maybe I could have gone up over 5,000 feet with a bubble in my eye. Maybe not. But, you know, whether we risked that or not, my family was cutting in and out on me. My family was, in no uncertain terms, not wanting me to stretch those limits. You know, not knowing the future, I find it exciting to go on a road trip and sort of have the excitement of not knowing where we are going to stay tonight. We have this view of travel. You know, we're going forward and you see where you're going, so obviously you should know where you're going. And we have many metaphors we live by, to use George Lakoff's term. But our time metaphor, we tend to view as Westerners as moving forward in time. But the Greek view of time was actually that I am standing here stationary and time is coming at me from behind. So the past is in front of you and the future is behind you because you don't know the future yet. Maybe you hear something approaching, but you know, until it's come past us, we don't see that. That's the classical Greek. I don't know if the modern Greeks still think of it that way. Another thing, you know, one learns as one gets older is this concept of pacing yourself. People keep saying, well, you know, how do you avoid burning out? You know, in some sense, I'm the only person who's not allowed to burn out. I have to recognize when I'm overstretched and you know, back off my own self or listen to my wife when she says, slow down. you know, and sometimes you burn out and you just have to take some time off and then come back. Sometimes my body says, you are not doing any more this year. I mean, I've had at least one year in this last 14 years where I basically had to take the whole year off when I had major stomach surgery, first stomach tumor. You know, after 6 months, I thought I was back, and I wasn't. It really took a year to get back from that. Linguistic. Right. Who spelled this? On our trip, we heard many different accents, most of which were perfectly comfortable understanding, everything from New Jersey to... But when we got down into Louisiana, we went into a restaurant, and they'd ask us a question, and we'd say, what? And he's like, you know, they really bend it enough, and it's not a popular enough accent like on TV that you don't hear it all the time. So it's like, I'm going to have to tune my ear up to this. Another linguistic notion as you go around is this notion of frame shifting. This actually, my father learned language this way when he was growing up. He would speak, at home they spoke what they called Low German, but it was really Flemish. At church they spoke High German and Hochdeutsch. And at school, they were in Canada at the time, they spoke English. So he would speak, he knew where he was supposed to speak each language. And kids are like this. If they speak one language at home, a different language at school, you can't get them to speak the other language because they don't do it there. And that's how they classify it in their brain, is by the location they are or the context. We do that a little bit with computer languages. If I am, you know, doing this, I will use that language. If I'm doing that, I will use that language. The plural culture is more like, I don't know if this is the technical term for it, but small cultures that migrate around Europe, say circus performers or gypsies or these sorts of folk. They know many different languages, depending on where they are. But instead of doing the frame-shifting thing, the way their cultural work is they'll just intermix all the different languages. It's like, you know, inline Perl 5, inside Perl 6 or something. Only they don't even declare it. They just switch, and everyone's expected to follow along. So they actually speak this, you know, language that is a conglomerate of a number of different languages. Now a computer, you know, can't keep up with that way a human can, so we have to at least declare what languages we're in. So those of you who have kids know that they will, if you're on a car trip, they'll say, "Are we there yet, Daddy? Are we there yet?" But this travel metaphor sneaks into our programming. I mean, it's not necessarily Perl here, but you see, while we are not at the end of the file, then get another line. And that, you know, that's just a race condition waiting to happen because another line might become available, you know. So we tend to discourage this sort of thing, but it can be more subtle. In Perl 6, a lot of the things we run into, we have lazy lists. They can be infinite. If the list array here happens to be infinite or very large, if you ask for the number of elements in it and it has, you know, 500 million in it, it's going to calculate how many elements there are, and then it will start the loop. So we've had to weed out some of those usages in order to allow the concept of very large lists to be done lazily. This idea that we'll tell your kid we'll get there when we get there and not before, but you know the idea is you know asking beforehand, you know, whether this operation will succeed, our there-ness, is not really terribly useful. On IRC channels, we say don't ask to ask, just ask. You know, you get tired of people saying I have a stupid question. Yes, that's a stupid question. But more than that, just some child-rearing advice. When they ask you that, teach them to figure out how far it is. Teach them to read the road signs. And you know, you'll end up with smart kids like ours here. Where did I put my Lewis picture? Oh, I know. It's in miscellaneous. Yeah, I missed a really great opportunity here. He got his CS degree this last year. If I put him in the opposite order, it could have been a pun on C.S. Lewis. But, well. So, whatever. And anyway, we got smart kids partly because, you know, we recognized when there were learning opportunities. You teach them to measure things, you know, whether you're measuring the distance or when you're computer programming, you measure things. By measurement, we now know that Rokudo on more VM, the startup time is faster than Perl plus Moose. Now maybe the Moose folks will catch up again, I don't know. And it's one of the few places we actually beat Perl 5.
This week.
But you know, various maps and charts. For instance, Yeah, it did, didn't it? That is very oddly rendered. Anyway. You know, we have these benchmarks that we do, so we can tell that Perl beats Rokudo more a little bit on this one, and Rokudo more beats Perl 5 on this one. Now, on most of them, Perl 5 still comes out ahead, but then again, it's had a you know, a several decade head start. So, but more is catching up. So you know, we measure, and you find interesting patterns in here. You know, there's an interesting pattern where Perl 5 has a scaling problem of some sort. Either that, or our test has a problem. There are some that are that way in the other direction too, where it doesn't scale well. Of course, the harmonic series, everyone fails at that eventually. And down to some very interesting stuff pulled out of the Rosetta Code things, including the forest fire, which Perl 5 still really rocks on as of this. But, you know, the other thing we can do, this is actually a profile run on that forest fire benchmark. And we see that we can see how much of the time it's spent in interpreting just a pure interpreter versus type specialized frames versus ones that we actually, and we're actually, you know, getting some pretty good JIT going on here. The actual problem with this particular benchmark in Perl actually has to do with lack of a decent native array type yet. Shaped arrays. But you can go in here and see what that this anonymous block here is actually taking 15% of the overall time. It did on stack replacement. It's not jitting for some reason. So you can go in and look at these things. But being able to measure, you know, looking at the call graph, where the allocations were, how the GC did. These are all ways of measuring where you are and gauging your progress and knowing if you're going to have a place to stay tonight. Another thing that is this whole travel metaphor is, you know, you have to travel yourself. And so our entire programming paradigm up to here has mostly been you know, through the von Neumann bottleneck, the computer does one thing at a time. Now we're starting to get into threads and various forms of parallelism and concurrency. But we have to change the perception of programmers too, to some extent. You know, Go 2, it may not be harmful, but it's a single-threaded idea. Well, people think of it as single-threaded. I'm here in this program, now I'm here in this program, now I'm there in that program, and I go to here and I'm back here. You know, that's identifying your ego with the execution pointer. And instead of me going to the data, as this traditional view is, what we're starting to have to move to is this notion that the data is coming to me. The data can flow in multiple routes. You know, when you pull up Google Maps and you ask for a route, it gives you several alternatives and you can drag it around and say, I could do this, I could do that, I could do that. What we can't do is the quantum mechanical thing and do all at once yet. Maybe we don't want to do that. But this idea that our programs are becoming more like economic models of the data, where the data goes. You know, it's like supply chains in economies. You know, I get this from you. Where do you get that from? So, you know, you have a statement like this in Perl, and in the Perl 5 way of looking at this, everything is evaluated eagerly. So it has to know everything that's in the input array, and then it passes that whole array to the process, and then it passes the whole result to the output. And that's sort of it's not how, you know, things flow in an economy, a little bit at a time. So you know, the natural, you know, we all know the Schwarzian transform, which is a shorthand here. Obviously, you know, a map could, if the things you're mapping over are independent of each other, you can do it lazily. And it is, in fact, lazily done in Perl 6. Perl 6, even though, sort is not naturally lazy. It has to have all its input. So there's this kind of negotiation on your supply chain going on, and this is something we're thinking about. You know, this map could be done lazily, but the sort says I want it all anyway. So the map should optimize for doing it all at once, if that is an optimization. On the other hand, a map coming out of the sort can't be lazy. As long as your sort algorithm you know, produces the lowest value, if you're only interested in the lowest value, you don't actually have to do all the other merges if, say, it's a merge sort. So you could, it might not actually be a win, but you could actually negotiate a lazy implementation between that map and that sort. But in Perl 6, this idea of laziness, you know, we all love laziness, and we think we should be lazy, the computer shouldn't. We're sort of extending that notion, not just the idea of lazy lists. Exceptions are a little lazy, and they don't actually throw until you try to misuse them. This idea of a failure that throws lazily. Contexts are lazy. In Perl 5, the compiler knows at compile time whether the thing is a list or scalar context. In Perl 6, it doesn't know until you actually pass what we call a parcel. A parcel just is pre-context, a tuple of things that you're going to evaluate. Until it actually gets passed somewhere, it doesn't know whether it's going to be in list context or item context. And this works out quite nicely, but it's a different way of thinking about it. These policies on the map sort map thing that it is passing back and forth, we're discovering those have to be created lazily. And indeed, some of the optimizations can be done at compile time, but many of them, excuse me, many of them, you don't have all the information you need until you actually start running the program a while. So we have JIT optimizations as well, and we're getting pretty good at those. Well, Jonathan and Brr are getting pretty good at those. And you want to make your optimization decisions based on as much knowledge as possible. Sometimes you know what you need to know at compile time, but that's not always the case. Just as we, you know, delegate some of our decision making to our little navigator, we love to call it the Nagivator. That is not intentionally misspelled. I don't know why that's never caught on, but. Recalculating. But just as we delegate decisions to the navigator, we declare things that we want to go here, but then we let the navigator, you know, decide certain things about the route for us. And then we actually, you know, again, control it at a lower level. And this, you know, This is the not only the way that the industry is going in terms of technology, it's also the way we're going in terms of community. Because you know there are many of us, and we are learning to pass things on to people who are better at it. You know, we would not have a JIT without other people, because you know I don't know JITs. So you know this idea of you know here is a processor, whether it's a programmer or a speaker. You know, a programmer takes a list of issues, and that might be an arbitrarily long list of issues. It keeps growing, doesn't it? And produces patches, and those are you know processed through one at a time. You know, if I had to write all the talks for all the conferences I ever were going to go to in advance, I would die. I have a hard enough time writing one talk for one conference, especially when I've been driving across the country and around Austria. But this idea is we're pushing the intelligence down the stack some, and it's what we have to do. But we can kind of be tricksy about it. What we're kind of doing in Perl 6 really is we're tricking the user into declaring things by accident when we can. I mean, we also have more official declarations if you compare with Perl 5 that, you know, overload sub for both methods and functions. We separate those. We actually have a declarator for attributes and state variable. Well, you guys borrowed state variables from Perl 6. We have explicit declarators, but there's also ways in which things look procedural, and you think of them as procedural, but they actually are declarations of what you want. So hyperoperators that we have, they're actually declaring, I don't care what order you do these things in. I mean, you think of them as procedural, but even more to the point, our grammars. You know, we took regular expressions and amplified them so you could write entire parsers and grammars in them. And if you look at the spec very carefully, it says these things at the beginning of an expression are declarative and the rest of them are procedural. And the computer is very carefully saying, we know these things are declaring a longest token. So when you write this grammar, it actually goes out and looks at all these declarations and says, for this language, I know how to write a lexer for you. So you never have to write your own lexer. I never did like writing lexers, and people never liked the lexers I wrote, so that's a good thing. But this idea that we're pushing some of the intelligence down, sometimes we have to make the user aware of it, and sometimes not. But you know, these attributes that we think of as attributes of a programmer, if we want our computers to start behaving as our agents, they have to start learning some of those tricks too. Hopefully they'll learn the laziness and impatience before the hubris. But skip that, I'm running out of time. But the idea of traveling somewhere, you know, you just get closer. or you know why you're going out of the way, you know, for scenery or something. And as long as you have a convergent process, you're going to get there eventually, or drive over a cliff, but, you know. So, you know, how close are we with Perl 6? Well, here's what we have left. We have the great list refactor, that's not the right clause. That's a pun. They're all puns, I guess. But the great list refactor, I'm getting tired. Can you tell? We have these different policies that we're dealing with on lists. Perl 5 basically knows about the all policy and sync. It knows that you want all the values of a list, and it knows that you want none of them. You just want to evaluate the thing because in void context. But to those, to get the to where we want to be with parallel processing and concurrency and the expressiveness of lists that can be infinite, we've long been exploring this idea of lazy. But lazy by itself is quite inefficient because you're doing things one at a time. It's not cache friendly. So we have ways of thinking of, we currently are starting to prototype ways of batching things. We're thinking about how to silo things between cooperating threads. And hyper, we have specifically on hyper operators, but we don't have a general hyper context for list. Because if you're going to do things in parallel on list, you have to have a mechanism for asking a list, you know, I want to divide and conquer. Give me two lists, beginning and the end. So if you have a list that can only do a head and a tail, like in Lisp, you can't get there. So that has some ramifications for our data structures. And race is really just a hyper that says, I don't care what order you return the values in. I actually want a race condition. So that's more like what you get with Google when you search for something and it does a MapReduce. You know, it's just giving you what it thinks of first, or you know, it's like Watson in the Jeopardy trial. It's, you know, it's coming up with the top N answers that it can think of first, and then picking one. So we have all those things that we're working out. That's the great list refactor, and it has to deal with infinities and all sorts of cool stuff. But that's part of what we're going to hackathon on this weekend. Normalization form graphene. Which is NFG is also, you won't find this in the Unicode standard, but it's our idea of presenting characters as the user thinks of them, not as the Unicode consortium thinks of them. You have NFD, which is fully decomposed. You have NFC, which has certain precomposed characters, especially for the lucky Europeans. And NFG says everybody should have precomposed characters, even the people in languages that they didn't do that in Unicode. So basically take the same sort of idea of making composed characters and make temporary composed composed characters for those languages. And then they get to do a substr and think of this character as one wide, even though it's got several code points in it. That's the idea. It's another internationalization thing that we're just trying to be better than any other language. And finally, the last thing that we really think we need before 6.0 is officially out is native shaped arrays. No, not national, not those guys. Though they had to do with the creation of Perl 1, that's another story. But things like this, where you can declare a 10 by 10 array of a matrix of native integers, or a bit vector that's actually really got bits in it. That's one of the spots that's a little weak at the moment. And I could show you various programs that I had that I could demonstrate where that would be useful, for instance, in the forest fire, or in my quizzing editor, or in my programs, which for instance, if I want to look things up in my Chinese dictionary, as I was talking about, you know, if I have a child on the left, well, there's lots of characters with a child on the left. So I can look things up. What it's actually doing when I do that, though, is doing all this bit mapping with vectors of these entries are in these locations, those entries in that location, and it just ands all the bit maps together from this database. But I don't really have time to talk about all that. So I was gonna. The plan had been to, you know, just talk about a few things and then open it up for questions. But I seem to have gabbed the whole hour. but I will be here.
What happened to Eager?
Eager. Well,
yes, the
what happened to Eager? That's going back to this. All is basically Eager, but, you know, Eager, there's different shades of Eager. Eager is basically everything that's the opposite of lazy here. So we're more finely dividing. I can speak English. The concept of eager, and so I didn't want to use eager in this list just because that's confusing. But you can do lazy lists in batches if you don't have to do it strictly lazy. There's some recursive algorithms that has to be strictly lazy to work, but most of the time, something is lazy. You could work ahead in batches and get good cash benefits from that. Right now, our gather take is too lazy, and you added an eager prototype. But the idea is, the compiler should be able to negotiate that eagerness without you having to tell it. So all is the most like what you think of as eager, saying, you know. Notionally, I want all these values, but practically speaking, you could still do that in batches. On the other hand, hypers and races, the race could be done in batches, I suppose. The hypers, you really have to have all of them because after you've done all the things in parallel, you have to reserialize them in the order that they originally were. That's the difference between hyper and race. So there's all these different little considerations. That's why I didn't use the eager in that list. I don't know when dinner is supposed to be and how long you want to sit here. I mean, I can answer questions all night if you like. You don't have to do that. Thank you.